how can we change U.S. foreign policy? Well, I'm with an organization, my nationwide organization that I sort of strengthening with, is the U.S. campaign to end the Israeli occupation. And we're a coalition of over 300 groups across the United States. And there's two approaches that we are trying right now. Number one is the simple political approach of getting the grassroots out there to talk to our politicians, our representatives. Even though it might seem hopeless at times, it's only going to, I do think the situation is only going to change when enough people in the United States wake up and tell their representatives, hey, we don't want to be supporting this, we want to be supporting peace. So you need to at least make that a conditional on steps for peace. Another approach, there is the BDS movement, the boycott, divestment, sanction. This movement uses what happened in South Africa as a model for trying to put pressure to resolve the conflict. In South Africa, of course, the United States lagged on saying, you know, apartheid's wrong. So what did everybody, people in civil society got together and said, okay, we are going to boycott or try to divest or things like that. And that put pressure on South Africa. And eventually it did press for change. We're talking about Israelis and Palestinians in country. There is a realization now that they can't resolve the conflict without help from people from the outside putting pressure on both all sides to compromise. And so that is what we're doing.
I'm going to pass out a congressional bill while she goes fix the computer. It's something we read out, wrote out. Yeah, I think anyway, if Americans only knew or looking at it, Jewish Voice for Peace, I talked to Cindy Levy, and Yanni Rusova, at J Street over here. And what we're trying to do in this country is find a common consensus insofar as what kind of direction all these organizations need to head to pass legislation on this issue. Now you're probably thinking, why should I care? Why should Americans like me, you know, made of Mexican, Japanese American, why should we care? I'll tell you why we should care. Because your tax dollars are going toward this suffrage. In addition to those tax dollars that come from your parents and you, every one of you, going to the suffering, our reputation abroad in here is being ruined. People hate us because of this issue. And it's not just in the Middle East. So if you look at this, you know, form an opinion. Other people are looking at it. It's just a rough draft. It's an ugly rough draft. You know, I'm not the best. I wrote it. But, however, people are looking at it, they're going to chop it up, and the most difficult problem we have right now is the one or two state solution. No one can agree on whether it should be a one or two state solution. However, one thing I'll tell you is, well, what should we push for? I'm going to tell you what you need to push for. We need to make that aid conditional. It's unconditional, according to House of Representatives Bill 1105, Omnibus Appropriations Act of 2009. Dave Maddow said 2010 they'll pass another one. You're not going to stop this problem until you make that aid conditional. You have to tell these politicians that we don't want our tax dollars going there. There's not enough Muslim Americans here to pressure these politicians. Did you get it working?
Yes, we have. Okay.
So what you need is all the people that care for peace, African Americans, you know, those Caucasian Americans that have human civil rights organizations themselves. Because, you know, there's some good white people. We got to remember William Lloyd Garrison, you know, who started the abolition movement. And honestly, those are the kind of people that actually get things done because they have a lot of respect and a lot of resources already here in America. It's going to take a multi-ethnic, multi-organizational effort. You're not going to get anything done without it. Muslims, Jews, Christians are going to have to do this. It's going to take a lot of love, a lot of will to coexist. I've talked enough. I think we get
a quick response. Quick response to the wonderful question. That's the way I use from this. It's for student of history, student of democracy. Basic definition of democracy is one way to participate in your democracy is by showing your opinion, by speaking to your elected representatives, by writing to your to the newspapers. So express yourselves, and you have all the right to do it. And you'll be a good American, a loyal American if you did it. And hence, you can help one at a time, you can help change the public.
Most importantly, you want to get on the nerves. At Clemson, we didn't have that many people. I got on everybody's nerves. I challenged professors. I talked to the most conservative people until I got sick. Now we're about to have this lecture at Clemson. Six universities in this state. We're about to have a lecture at Clemson. It's going to be the largest attendance. And everybody's shocked. And on our documentary, you see people in public places saying, I believe in peace in Palestine and Israel. Out loudly, without any fear of scrutiny. If there is any change, you're going to have to write history. Not me, not these organizations. Organizations mean nothing. It's individuals like you. When you get up and do something, you're going to get something changed. So, I'm tired of talking. She's going to take it over. Sorry.
زياد جناح قمرنو